In this edition of Art Loft, the curator's collection, Bleeding Palm, featuring Hernan Bass.
This is a full room installation, and it's a way of the artists sort of sharing their own thought process.
I wanted the whole room to have a sort of Victorian feel about it, so the paintings for me are more of a decorative panel, like almost like a wallpaper for the work that I made specifically for the show.
Frank Falestra, AKA Rat Bastard.
Where we invite musicians from around the country and some from abroad to perform here in Miami to do more, you know, avant-garde or noisy or, you know, different types of music.
Alan Bellman.
And I work for Timely Marvel Comics in 1942. I started doing backgrounds, Captain America.
And Oh Miami.
Hard to accept that those big lumps of affection would find alternate places to stick, that Simon and Taylor would be swept away and marry others.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from the WPBT2 studios in Miami, this is Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Welcome to Art Loft's The Curator's Collection, a series of monthly specials inviting leading South Florida galleries, museums, and local arts innovators to curate episodes based on their artistic vision. Together, we'll discuss the selected profiles' impact on our arts and local community. For this episode, we're broadcasting from WPBT2's Studio A, and we welcome guest curator Ronnie Rivera, founding member of Bleeding Palm. Ronnie, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm a Miami native. I am a filmmaker and a visual artist. I co-founded Bleeding Palm, which is an art collective of about six people, and we do various art projects throughout Miami, animation, web, and graffiti.
So thanks, Ronnie. We're happy to have you here on the show. Next, the first selection of the curator's collection, Bleeding Palm, right here on Art Loft.
The Adventures of Christopher Boss in the Multiverse.
I am Star Prince Zordon Akilabatar.
But the evil internet sorceress was being watched.
Oh, look, I found them.
The Wolfman traveled through the portal and confronted Bosch.
Star Prince, I found you just in time. You must help us fight Jillian, the evil sorceress. She is very evil and planning some terrible things.
Why did you wait so long to seek me out?
It was very hard to find you.
I'm sorry. I can't help you. I will only fail again.
Hello. I'm the Miami Heat player, Mike Miller.
The Wolfman Mystique had no choice but to enter Miami Heat player Mike Miller and take control of his mind and body.
I have no other choice.
As the game went on, Bosch started noticing Mike Miller was acting strangely.
Hey, Mike Miller, what's the big idea?
I'm the Mystic Wolfman, you fool. I must train you so you can defeat the evil sorceress.
I told you I didn't want to. I am happy being an above-average professional human millionaire basketball player.
I won't leave Mike Miller's body until you are ready. I love you, Christopher Bosch.
Whatever, dude.
Welcome back to Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. The first piece chosen by our guest curator features artist Hernan Bass. So tell us what it was about Hernan's work that caught your attention.
I've always been a fan of his paintings. This particular installation was at the Bass Museum, which I worked at, and every day I would go down and take a look and discover something new in his personal collection. I think it's fascinating when artists collect work and to see what they collect, and he collects really bizarre, crazy things. And our install team had to paint the room salmon pink, and that paint never dried.
Great, so I remember seeing that installation and it really was fantastic. Now we can let our viewers take a look. Enjoy Hernan Bass.
We're currently in the exhibition titled Time, so we decided to choose artists that explore the concept of time in different ways. Hernan Bass was originally a Miami-based artist, and for this particular show, he's actually sharing his own collection of over 100 objects from his own cabinet of wonders. And he's also included some paintings.
It's basically a collection of everything I've been collecting for the past 10 years. I'm an artist, but I also sort of am inspired by the different objects and sort of become a collector vicariously. And so this is basically at least 10 plus years of items that have inspired me or relate to the work that I've done in the past.
Two of the most recent acquisitions that he's included in this particular viewing is a taxidermied flamingo and a taxidermied black swan.
With the Bass Museum, their whole mission is to sort of mix the old with the new, so I wanted to show these antiquities alongside things that are contemporary that still relate. Like the Lego haunted house refers to the contemporary version of a haunted house where it's become kind of kiddie friendly, but then I also have a model of the Amityville horror house, which is the opposite of kid friendly. So I like having that mix between the old and the new.
There's one section that deals with funeral rites, ideas of mourning or loved ones. There's a section on young explorers. There's a section on the life of the dandy. So if you take your time to look, there's actually interesting objects.
There's this phenomenon on eBay called the ghost in a jar phenomenon, and this guy sold a supposed ghost captured in a jar. When that whole phenomenon happened, I went searching for my own ghost in a jar, and the one I found was a supposedly haunted copy of the Ghostbusters soundtrack from 1984. And the cassette's supposedly haunted, and it's kept in this jar. That sort of suspension of disbelief and just odd, you know, weirdness is, I don't know, that's one of my favorite objects in the show.
Hernan is usually known for his paintings and drawings. This is a full room installation, and it's a way of the artists sort of sharing their own thought process.
I wanted the whole room to have a sort of Victorian feel about it, so the paintings for me are more of a decorative panel, like almost like a wallpaper for the work that I made specifically for the show.
Someone is to come and visit the Bass Museum for this particular exhibition. It's sort of a sampling of what you'll see in the near future as well.
If you come to see the show, like, prepare to be a little spooked. Just expect to be a little surprised by some of the stuff. It kind of covers a lot of different genres.
Now, back to Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. This edition of Art Loft is being curated by Bleeding Palm, and our guest curator is the collective's founder, Ronnie Rivera. The next selection features an introduction to the International Noise Conference by Frank Falestra. So you've attended this event annually.
Yes.
Tell me what it is that you like about this event.
What I love about this event is you will always see something you've never seen before, and you'll always hear something you've never heard before. And Frank Falestra, also known as Rat Bastard,
right,
is a pillar of the music community down here.
Yeah, you know, when I watched the segment before, you had every noise imaginable. So, I mean, it makes it a really unique festival.
Yeah, it really is. You get a lot of exciting things that happen in there, and people just, there's always people that are trying to push, you know, what they're doing. It performance art really like mixes with the music, and you get a lot of strange things.
It's good that it gives artists a place to really express themselves.
Yeah.
Well, let's let you check it out for yourselves. Now we have Frank Falestra on the International Noise Conference.
The International Noise Conference, it's in its 10th year. It's an annual event where we invite musicians from around the country and some from abroad to perform here in Miami to do more, you know, avant-garde or noisy or, you know, different types of music. It's a four-day event. The first two nights are the Miami locals. The third night is more the Tampa, West Coast, Florida, South Florida artists generally. And then the final night is mostly national and international groups. Most people that look at Miami now, they look at hip-hop conventions and DJ conventions and electronic festivals. And we were actually around long before that. We've had people from Australia, Canada, Paris, France, England, yeah.
Yeah.
for all 10 years, we held it here at Churchill's Pub, and I've been here for years doing all kinds of noisy avant-garde music before then, and then we decided to put a festival together to invite people from around the country to come down and mix in with the locals. We prefer no laptops, you know, every once in a while you might see one, it depends on the artist. We just want more of action type of sound, people that are using their bodies or using instruments and something more live, something you can see rather than just someone staring at a laptop and playing a grid. You'll see a lot of conventional instruments, and yet you'll see a lot of like primitive items like contact mics or pieces of metal or whatever, you know, they think they can generate sound on. They're experimental, mostly. They try to do more maybe performance art mixed in with sound or just an experimental sound that's trying new ideas. We try to keep it at 15 minutes or less so we can have more performers perform. And in this type of music, like 15 minutes is pretty much enough. I mean, 8 minutes seems like forever if you're actually playing this stuff. We get a pretty good range of all kinds of people who are interested in music. They're just people who have open minds and they're curious about different sounds and want to see something new. The crowd's pretty much involved. You'll see the crowd like hover around the artist. There's a lot of networking going on. Some new artists that come down, and then there's some of the older artists that's been down for like 10 years. They always come up with a new idea every year. It's like they challenge themselves to come up with something new every year, and it's usually a surprise. It kind of mixes the Miami artists with these national artists and some international artists. It gives them a chance to see what's going on in these other cities without leaving this one. We've actually toured the event a couple of times. We went out through the United States. We play about 30 cities in about a month. We've actually gone to Europe and did about 15 cities in Europe. Have an open mind, you're gonna see some interesting music that you probably thought you'd ever hear. And the way they present the music is interesting as well.
Many describe Alan Bellman as a legendary talent, but they also talk about his respect and care for other artists. Ronnie, how'd you become interested in Alan's work?
I've collected comics my whole life, and I was not aware of Bellman until I watched the episode on Art Loft. And then I got interested in his personal philosophy about never giving up and how important it is to learn to draw for artists.
And you collect comic books yourself, right?
Yes, yes. I've always collected comic books.
My husband's a big collector as well. Who's your favorite comic? What's your favorite comic?
Silver Surfer.
Very nice. Yeah. Now we'll take a look at artist Alan Bellman.
My name is Alan Bellman. And I work for Timely Marvel Comics in 1942. I started doing backgrounds for Captain America. I always wanted to draw comics. My father had a bakery. Every chance I had, I'd draw on the paper bag. And I'd open a book and there was a white space in a hard-covered book. I'd draw in there. It's just something you have in you. It was Columbus Day, 1942. And I said to my dad, I says, I'll go tomorrow, it's a holiday. He said, no, you go today. I said, Dad, and we went back and forth, and he won. And I thanked my dear dad because I don't know where I'd be now if I didn't listen to him. Because I got that job in 10, 15 minutes. They said, you start Monday. I went to the High School of Industrial Art, and I went on and off at night at Pratt Institute. But actually, it was on the job that I got my training and the ability to improve, the opportunity to keep improving my work. And I always worked and strived to have a better job. I was never really ever happy, whatever I do, even now. I always feel I could do better, more and more, but when I do a drawing for a fan, I want it to be good. I'm so happy to draw it the old way, because this is what the fans want. When I get a note or email saying, Mr. Billman, you made me happy with your work, it's framed. This means more to me than anything else. It's just a personal gratification that I get that I can make someone happy. It was just my art. They like my art. Some stories I love to do more than other stories. It's like an actor getting a script, and they read the script, and they say, not for me, and they give it to somebody else, becomes a big hit, you know? But the fact is, it's the same thing. But certain stories just would motivate me more than other scripts. Doing a comic book, or doing any kind of comic strip, is doing a movie. You have your long shot, your close-up, your bird's eye view, worm's eye view. You have to change each panel so you keep the interest of the reader. A lot is left to the imagination, and the writer would describe saying, have him drinking or something to that effect, but use your own imagination. It's like I said, it's like doing a movie, and you have to think as a movie with still pictures. There was one book already written about the comic book industry, but it came and went. But I had spoken to many writers. I said, why don't you write a book about the comic book industry? Everyone had a story to tell. You're living in the best country of the world. The opportunities are here. You cannot give up. You cannot surrender with rejection, because you will hit somewhere. Learn how to draw. Do not copy the comic book characters, because you'll never learn to draw. Learn how to draw anatomy, a woman's anatomy, a man's anatomy. So when you put the costume on a man, you will know where the muscles are. You'll know where the hands are. I always wanted to draw and tell a story in pictures. And my dream came true at the tender age of 18. Hi, my name is Alan Bellman, and I'm an wrong meeting. Excuse me. That's my cane. Sometimes I like to raise cane myself. Let's be nice to everyone. We cannot be everyone's friend, but let's try. There's so much going on right now. So please, please, cheers.
In our final story, we are introduced to the month-long poetry blowout that is O Miami. With so many events hosted during their annual run, it's no surprise that this segment was chosen. So Ronnie, why did you curate the O Miami segment?
Because I love Scott and Melody. I love working with them, and I really enjoy the way they get poems out into the community in a really fun way.
I agree. I loved seeing all their street sign poems that were all around the city. They really do creative things. Yeah. So we'll let our viewers take a look. This is O Miami.
O Miami is a month-long poetry festival that starts on April 1st and ends on April 30th. And the goal of the festival is for every single person in Miami-Dade County to encounter a poem during that 1 month span. We fly poems behind airplanes, the advertising banners. We put poems on lamppost banners around Miami-Dade County. We put poems on drink coasters that are going to be distributed to restaurants and bars. We're going to have, you know, 20-something events throughout the month. Then we'll also have about 15 projects, all of which are designed to push poetry out of its normal audience, or to put it another way, to reach out to the audience here in South Florida. And then we also mix poetry in our events with other genres. We'll also be doing some music and poetry collaborations, film and poetry. But we try to do things that mix up the audience for the genre. O Miami began in 2011. It was an outgrowth of the University of Wynwood, which is my organization. It's a fake university whose goal is to promote contemporary poetry here in Miami. We partnered with the Knight Foundation to try and create this festival. Said, okay, all right, well, we'll try and reach everyone with a poem, and we'll see what happens.
Today I'm giving a reading with Maureen Seaton and Julie Marie Wade at Books and Books. Well, some of my former students are now in charge of O Miami, and they're doing a fantastic job. And we would probably do a reading anyway. I have a new book out called Blowout, so I wanted to do a reading for it anyway. And it was Poetry Month and O Miami, so the whole thing just fell together really nicely.
Thank you all so much for coming. I'm really delighted to be here, and I love Books and Books. It's fantastic. I'm gonna start with a poem called Old Love Poems. I can burn the pictures, but not the poems, since I publish them in books, which are on shelves, in libraries, and in people's homes. Once my cousin told me not to write anything down because the words would be there forever to remind me of the fool I once was. My cousin was a little dog on the tarot card, barking at the fool's heels as I headed right towards the cliff. When James Taylor and Carly Simon broke up, I was shocked. Taylor's drug use or not, couldn't they work it out? I was in college, and though I didn't really believe in marriage, I believed in them. How could they part having written those love songs? And how could they go on singing those love songs after the divorce? But now, I know. After time, when they reached for those notes, there wasn't really a beloved there anymore. Just some raw material each left behind on the other's scarf or pillow. Raw material that transcended into something more real than they were. The lovers themselves, ephemeral muses. It's still hard for me to accept the notion of love outliving the lovers. A notion so romantic, it's unromantic. Hard to accept that those big lumps of affection would find alternate places to stick, that Simon and Taylor would be swept away and marry others. That need is not so much a deficit as an asset, like a wallet that keeps manufacturing its own dollar bills even after it's been robbed of everything. Or to say it another way, the plant that will bloom despite being uprooted, the new seedling that will pop up. It's hard to believe when you're down to your last penny, when the soil is dry and rocky and full of weeds, when your love is freeze-dried into a metallic pouch and you are full of snarky rage. You look back at a love poem you wrote and ask, did I really feel this way? Even if you no longer remember tenderness, even if the verse was simply artifice, your idea of love, a subspecies you made up to tag and define that one poor sap. You read the poem again, grateful, holding the words in your hands like a bunch of flowers.
Well, I hope it continues to grow and continues to be something that is meaningful to people here in Miami. I hope we continue to reach new people through contemporary poetry and bring more people into awareness of the genre and what it's doing. And I also hope we can continue to bring down world-class performers from different genres and make it something that people really mark off on the calendar.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. And a special thanks goes to Ronnie Rivera. For more information about Bleeding Palm, visit bleedingpalm.com. And let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. And get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. See you next time on Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Bye. And make it fun. Don't be boring.
Dude. Way to mess with my head. Like, yeah, don't mess.
Pressure. Founding member of Bleeding Palm. Ronnie, thanks so much for being with us. And tell us a little bit about yourself.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. That's where I thought Sean
Who am I again?
Sabotage me.
What do I do?
Do you know what you're going to say?
What am I doing? I am a filmmaker. That's what I am. Yes.
Right. Okay. All right, good.
A magician.
Okay, cool. Okay. Ronnie, welcome to the show. All right. All right, well.
Try that again. Was that garbage? It was garbage.
Okay.
How's
yeah.
my energy?
Let's pick up and your energy's fine.
That's fine. Okay.
And yes, because we want you to look as beautiful as you are.
Thanks.
All right, are we ready? Ronnie, we're happy to have you here on the show. The next the first selection of the Curate. Picking up the energy. Wake up over there.
Sorry,
come on.
Sorry. Okay.
Do this.
I'm not doing that.
Oh, come on, Killjoy. For more information about bleeding.
Bleeding. I'm just happy to.
Silence!
I just want to get out of here alive. This is so scary, by the way. Oh, it's so dark
and
in here.
You like it. Thank you. Ronnie, why did you curate the Oh Miami segment?
I don't actually have to. No. That was good.
Your turn.
That was really good.
Thank you.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and.
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.